Now, while homegrown films may be a little thin on the ground, Puttnam has ploughed a fertile furrow with a crop of successes. David, what were your feelings there at that moment when that Oscar was finally in your hands? Was this a natural stairway that you reached the top of?
No, I still haven't adjusted to it. Oscar isn't like an award. I've won one or two awards, not a lot. It's very different from the 25-yard swimming certificate. because it's mythic. It has nothing to do with reality. And I think that's why it probably takes a while to get used to, because I've really, to an extent, I've got to reorientate my career now and take into account the fact that I've done that and make it now not matter.
Now, when Chariots of Fire was nominated, as it were, to be the Royal Film Performance, you were saying this is the most important thing that could happen to the British film industry. Subsequent to the Oscar nomination, or the Oscar award, there are people saying, well, yes, this is, confirms our hope that Puttnam is the saviour, the last hope for the British film industry. Is it worth saving, or is its day past?
I think there's no single answer to that question. In many, many areas, its day is past. There's certainly the day of the local neighbourhood cinema, the day of the, you know, Saturday night at the pictures. That's past forever. On the other hand, the cinema has before it, the production end of the cinema has before it, I think, an opportunity that it's never had. Never had, certainly, until we blew it in the 30s when we allowed the Americans to dominate the industry. With cable television, with satellites, and every other form of distribution available to us.
You see TV as being the platform for films.
It is. You can't start telling people after they've been adjusted for 20 years to seeing things in the comfort of their own home that they must go out. I mean, I am as good as anybody at giving vent to the argument, the sociological arguments of the shared experience and the big screen, and I wish to God people would see the films I make and I'm involved in on a big screen with stereo sound, because that's the way they were made to be seen. But that's my opinion. You can't make people come and see it that way. Whatever happens, I mean, Chariots is a very successful film. It'll be seen by 3 or 4 million people.
Which is the same number of people who are seeing you now, in fact.
Well, that's what's so extraordinary.
The thing that strikes me about seeing a film at a cinema rather than watching it on television is that you take the positive step of going to the cinema saying, I want to see Chariots of Fire or whatever it may be. Whereas even if you do stay in one night to watch a film on television, you can't determine the context in which you see that film. The programme that precedes it, the programme that follows it, must inevitably impose itself to some extent on the way you receive that movie.
Right.
Now, how do you deal with that kind of a problem?
Well, I feel that off-air television, which is what we're appearing on today, is not and never will be the perfect medium for a feature film. The logical medium in the long run would be cable, which gives many of the features of the theatrical experience, i.e. you see it when you want to see it, you see it in its entirety, it isn't interrupted by commercials, you can probably plug most cable systems through your stereo and have good sound. I see cable as the absolute natural extension to the present exhibition sector, although the present exhibition sector will survive primarily as a promotional medium. As a shop window. You're always going to need that, and I think it's a very, very important function. Off-air television will always be the last offering, as it were, in the chain, and it's what you do with a film when you've basically exhausted the other options open to you.
Does this mean that we shall no longer have people sweating away in their garrets writing scripts for the most wonderful idea and sending them to you and saying, David, this is it, this is the great film, it needs to be seen at the Odeon Mile End or whatever, and this will enhance the lives of people in the East End?
Well, I think there is a misconception inherent in all of that. I once was sent a script which would have made a marvellous television play, and when I actually talked to the writer afterwards, I said, well, why on earth do you see this as a feature film? He said, well, you remember that shot where the pram runs backwards downhill? He said, I can't imagine that on television. Well, I mean, actually, to write a 90-minute play and have in mind a shot of a pram, that's nuts. I hope he's watching tonight. I mean,
What about the... how would you judge a script? I mean, you've given a comment there on one particular script. And does a script have to be obviously well-written? We must presuppose that. It must also have a sense of dramatic tension. But what about its content, its line of argument, its philosophy, if you like? Is that important to you?
Yes, very. I think, it's a subjective medium. In terms of I can only make decisions of what's important to me and what works for me. I couldn't make a range of films. I'm not particularly interested, for example, in thrillers. I don't know what makes a good thriller. I'm, for the first time, embarking on a comedy on Monday, and I'm very nervous. I'm not quite sure what makes a good comedy. For me, film is a subjective medium, and what it offers the audience an opportunity to do is what it did for me as a kid, which is to change places with someone who's 10 times your size on screen and to transfer personalities with that person. Now, quite clearly, that the inference of that is that you are transferring your personality with someone you find attractive, someone whose moral position you find something that you want to identify yourself with. It's a business of identity. So you loan that person your identity for 90 minutes or 100 minutes, and you are, and hopefully you leave the cinema feeling a bigger, better person than you were.
I wonder if there are any topics that you think could provoke anger in a cinema-going audience or a film-watching audience. Are there any subjects that will arouse anger in this perhaps cynical age?
Probably. I'm not sure I'm clever enough to make a film that would both arouse anger and ensure that that anger was properly directed. I think that requires a very, very substantial brain, and I'm not sure I'm just clever enough. And I've never yet actually worked with a director who I was absolutely sure had... Maybe Tony Garnett is the one person who I feel has got a very, very good grip of circumstances and situations and is prepared to put in the time and effort and energy to research things carefully enough to be fairly sure of his ground. I tend to trust Tony. Outside of him, I don't know. I've been very influenced by a film, Battle of Algiers. Do you ever see the Battle of Algiers? Pontecorvo. That, to me, is a film that expresses a great anger, and yet the overriding intelligence of the filmmaker comes through, the fact that he doesn't treat the French during Algiers as morons. He gives them an intellectual and emotional position. I'd like, we were talking before we came on about the Falklands Islands, I'd like to think that any decisions made here among people, not necessarily among politicians, about the Falklands Islands, took into account things that you and I can never know. How strongly the Argentinians feel about it, how much it's part of their, how much, you know, the notion of the Falklands not being Argentinian is part of their social fabric, you know, what they're taught at school. And I think unless we appreciate what the Falklands mean to the Argentines, it's very difficult for us to take a high moral tone.
Talking about the Argentines, it seems to be the most bizarre coincidence that Chariots is showing at this time and doing enormously good box office. How do you respond to that? A, you won't see the money, but apart from that...
First of all, we never will see the money. That's quite clear. It'll probably be spent on Mirage jets to to stray past. I think it's extraordinary. I think it's, I suppose, from a publicity point of view, a major coup. I'm sure I'll be told it is. It's amazing. I mean, it's the sort of thing you could never set up, could you?
What do you think? I mean, this is perhaps an impossible question, but what do you think? I mean, it's difficult enough to try and grope with the idea of what the Americans saw in Chariots of Fire to go and see it in their millions and also to award it the Oscar. But what would the Argentinians see it from a yet further removed from our culture?
I don't know, but I think it's a very, very good question, because I think unless we can answer that question, we're not really qualified to make major judgments about how the Argentinian population view the Falklands. I mean, I've got no brief whatsoever for the President Galtieri or any of that mob. I think they're probably a bunch of thugs, genuine thugs, and I'm sure the whole thing is entirely self-serving. But I happen to be a Spurs fan. I'm very keen on Mr. Ardiles. And if he's upset, I'm upset.
A neat bit of sidestepping there, David. I shall move on a bit further. And we've returned to the whole theme of anger.
Yeah.
And this whole business of morality in films, be it in Night Express and the speech that Billy Hayes made, the clip of which we showed, and the other bit that we referred to, where does justifiable provocation of people's moral outrage or anger tipple over into propaganda? And given that you're prepared to deal with anger and morality, and given also that you tell me that the government is keen to see Chariots of Fire to establish quite what the Argentinians might make of it.
I didn't tell you, you told me that.
Oh, did I really? Well, there you go. Well, there's information around to that effect.
I'm delighted to hear it.
Yes, go on.
Gosh.
It's a big question.
It's a huge question. It comes back to a facet of intelligence. Were I Isaiah Berlin, and God, I wish I was, I would feel secure, or I would feel secure making... Let me put it another way. I'd feel secure making a film based on a notion of Isaiah Berlin's, or based on Isaiah Berlin's notion of what was fair and just and correct. I don't feel that I'm old enough, although God knows I feel old a lot of the time, or experienced enough, or intelligent enough to make those kind of judgments on behalf of thousands of other people. And I think there's a very important aspect to this, that we in the media, you and I, have, along with the politicians of this country, maybe more than the politicians of this country, a massive responsibility for the world we live in and the tone of the world we live in. And I think the people who attempt to set that tone and who attempt to make those judgments better be damn sure that they're... judgments that their judgments in turn are well-founded.
It does also beg the question of accountability as well. I mean, to whom should we be accountable apart from our own conscience?
Yes.
Let's talk about the film itself, because I want to come back to this whole business about finance and filmmaking. You describe that always as a Cinderella film, which cost a relatively small amount, £2.5 million. Do you think that given Reaganomics and monetarism over here, that the entrepreneur spirit will be stimulated sufficiently to finance more films, be they inspired by you or anybody else?
Yes, I'm sure it'll have some sort of an effect. My concern is which entrepreneurs and stimulated in what direction. If it's the wrong sort of entrepreneurs and if they're merely stimulated towards the opportunity to make money, we will not have the sort of films that I'll reach a point where I'll wish probably the Chariots of Fire never happened.